publicly sewer. We look at that, and then we use the treatment facility to determine whether or not it's a point source, a land application system, or whether it's a septic system. So that we break those four caps in those three basic categories. The municipal, and this is original method, we used the municipal water use, the percent of indoor water use, the infiltration inflow, because in South Georgia there's a lot of inflow into the sewer system, so we add or subtract that, but in this case, add that in to get our total wastewater generation. So we're really relying on that municipal water use, how much of it is being flushed down the toilet or run down your sink. Yeah, very logical, pretty straightforward. And we are going to do a little different approach this time around. And we're really going to, it's this piece, is the projected municipal water use. Was that the best method to add into this and determine what the wastewater would be? We're still working on this, so bear with me. Some of the results, I'm still kind of scratching my head a little bit about. But the new method, so my first slide just told you what I said, my first bullet. The new method, rather than relying more directly on the water that goes into the toilet and the sink, it's really looking at the discharges itself. You know, what's actually being discharged by county, by facility. So Dr. Booth kind of wanted to look at that method, thought it was maybe a little bit better method, a little bit more precision to it. And so taking that 2014 discharges by county, then looking at an indexing factor using population increase, knowing there's a relationship between the population and water use, using that relationship to then adjust the 2014 discharge data out into the future. So that future water wastewater changes at a rate, not the exact same rate, but index rate for population. And then it incorporates a trend in the ratio centralized and septic to determine the predicted change in centralized flows by county. We got to get, and I know Cliff, you heard us talk a little bit about this. I'm a little still vague, and I know Dr. Booth is, I'm not picking on Dr. Booth, she's trying to generate all this stuff as quick as she can. Unfortunately, getting her exact method at the same time she's doing it is tough. And Cliff has that same dilemma working with Mark Masters. Yeah. So bear with us on this one. I'm still unclear if that trend, how she got that trend. Because we held that constant originally, and we're holding that constant for the septic side. So remember I told you we're saying septic and municipal water will be the same? But then she's doing something, I think, a little bit different here. Excuse me, I said septic. Wells and municipal supply. We're holding that ratio the same, but we're changing this a little bit. So bear with it. Again, I don't think there's any practical implications. It's the stuff that makes Shane and I a little bit crazy because we don't like to stand up here and tell you. And I'm not totally sure what's going on with that. But it's important to really understand that, and our commitment is to get that for you. The reason it's important is I don't really care what these bars look like. I mean, they bug me a little because they aren't the right size bar in terms of what I can see conceptually that she's doing. I'll work on those bars. The reason it bugs me is because of what you guys have as your vision goals for this region. You have a vision and goal for protected water quality, but you also have a lot of water quality challenges. And this municipal forecast will have an important bearing in terms of what that looks like in terms of water quality impairments. And when we get into that, that's a whole another ball of wax. So we want to make sure how these things get modeled in the resource assessment. So stay with us on that. But right now, the thing to know is, sure, the flows from round one are higher than those in the update. And again, I don't want to make too big of a deal out of it. But when something does something like this to me, hold on a sec. When the blue is less than the red, and then the blue is the same as the red, and then the blue is higher than the red, and I don't know why, then I can't feel good coming to this meeting today, so I'm sorry I can't explain that. But I will, Shane and I will explain that. it probably has something to do with this assumption on centralized sewer, and it might have something to do with kind of how she's treating LAF systems and some assumptions there. I just don't know that.
Yeah, what I would add there is the reason this one's a little more funny, first one, and really the big change was population. We kind of knew what the trend was, so it made sense to us all intuitively. Here you're dealing with population change and a different methodology. And those two mixed together are, our first take is let's dig into this a little bit first.
Because what's happening between round one and round two with population, which is a key driver for water use, population's flattening out. This isn't, not like that. Again, I belabor that enough. Just was trying to prove to you guys that I'm getting older, but I'm not that easy to pull it out.
So, well, I know that we talked about this the first go around, that there is an overall leaning towards going away from the LAS systems, and also folks that are on septic, which is the LAS system. So we're trying to get more people into the treated water. So I'm sure there's some permit threshold about 20 years into the future there that's probably driving a lot of that.
And there's, to Scott's point too, I think there's another smaller category beyond the larger LAS systems, which are kind of those, I forget what. How Dr. Booth characterized them, they're more like the lagoon systems where they're kind of a subsurface discharge, and they're a surface impoundment that basically seeps.
Yeah.
It's not a true LAS.
I don't know how that works out.
Yeah. And so we're uncertain maybe how that could be factoring into a little bit of what we're seeing there as well. But again, we'll get that nailed down. I will just say, again, practical implications. A lot of folks in South Georgia originally wanted to go to LAS systems because of low flow, high temperature, and Tom, you know this from the work that you and some work that PCA does. Discharge into a receiving stream that has high temperature and low flow is not a fun thing to do. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Shane real quick to pick through the industrial water and wastewater.
Lay that caught up. So thank you for letting us do that. I just got a text back from Jennifer. So the venue is set. We are going to be in Dublin for our joint meeting, but I don't have a date. So it will be in June. We're in Dublin. And I just have to for her to let us know when we have a date. So maybe she'll text me back. Okay, so for industrial, as we know, water is needed for industrial process, sanitation, cooling, and some domestic use. The water for industrial is based on production, so it's not as related to population. And employment is in link to production. So updates on the employment data are not available at this time. So with that, the industrial forecasts are not actually being updated at this time for this plan. The recommendation from EPD is to maintain the round one estimates for industrial water and wastewater. But this is one of our jobs, is to come to you as the council, because you guys have boots on the ground in this area, and ask, have there been any changes since we finalized the plan in the industrial sector for your region? And I don't know if there's some initial thoughts that come to mind that you would share with us, or as you go back and kind of talk to folks and you could report back to us, in a different manner, whether it's email or at the joint meeting. But right now, where we are is we would offer to say we're just going to hold those projections where they were. So, open for discussion.
Yeah, I haven't heard of any major things changed on the industrial side. I don't really have anything that they've seen or read about in their local communities that impact this number very much.
You can see too, this graph shows you the numbers for the region in round one. It's not big, first one is filled, and those numbers are majorly different when you look at coastal, because you got like international paper there. The paper still is the big one, but still only 9 MGP. Not a lot.
There's been some proposals in the region for large water users possibly come in, but none of that materialized.
Okay. And this plot here, again, shows you the round one data. The pie chart there for 2010 on the left, you know, 92% of the water is sourced from groundwater, and 7% comes from surface water.
Who's using surface water?
I don't know if that was on our previous slide or not.
We talk about this pretty regular. I don't know who has a major industrial surface. I know there's a permit for them, but they're not using.
Yeah, it's probably one permit and it's one MGD, right? That's what it looks like to me.
I'll see if I can find anything. Go on ahead. If not, we'll get to an answer to that. But I'll let it. I have a document here.
The permit down here, that may not be accurate. That is the permitted. That is permitted and not based on actual reported use. Is that?
I would imagine that when we use the permit, you know, as a basis for doing the forecast, and then these two graphs show what we said we thought it would be when we did the original plan in 2010, and, you know, essentially not showing a lot of growth through 2050. And then I do have one more graph. Again, it's an aggregation of the Swan Scatilla as a region as a whole, but we're trying to show two things on this graph. The red, the darker red colors, and it's really hard to see on here, it's supposed to show you the difference in the source of the water, so most of it, if I use this one as an example.
Oh,
I think we're going to You're still alive.
Yes, we need to do that.
Hey, man, we're lucky to get lunch out of it. I wonder if we're going to stick with lunch. Yeah, man, I'm going to have to stay with lunch. Let them work on pushing that thing over there when they want to slide it, man. All right,
we're back. Okay, so what I was going to show here is that for 2010, the darker red is showing you the groundwater source, and then the small sliver is the surface water, and that's the source of water. And then this shows you the wastewater that's generated and where it goes. So in this case, most of it goes to the lighter gray, which is a point discharge,
and then the darker gray goes to an industrial, industrial goes to municipal wastewater. So that's what that graph shows. And again, we're just showing you, this is information that was in the round one report, and the suggestion is, given that we don't foresee any big changes in the last 5 years in the industrial sector, we feel like those are pretty good estimates.
And the only thing I'd add for those folks that might remember this is y'all did elect, because you remember we kind of grew, I won't get into too much detail, but Tom, you'll remember because there was a lot of not perfect feeling about this, but to forecast industrial water, we would love to have water by production unit. Industries do not like to give that information out because it ties to the bottom line. If you're able to produce the same product with less water, people like to then snoop around and try to figure out what you're doing. So they don't like to give any of that data. We'd love to get it. So what we have to do is use employment, which is an okay way to do it, but there is not as strong a correlation between employment and water use as we'd really like to have. So recognizing some of that and then recognizing what sectors were growing and which ones were more flat, we had a pretty flat projection. So when we talked to our council, remember last time, we said, you know, we get that, and we understand that. But we'd also like to have an alternate industrial forecast. And if you recall, we went ahead and we had a 5 MGD value that we said, you know, this area is attractive to folks. We do think people will come down. There's abundant groundwater resources. So we do have an alternate forecast. These slides that Shane just showed you was our baseline forecast. But we'll certainly keep that same concept in mind as we. And I can't get you that answer on the surface water, but we'll try to figure out where that might be coming from.
Yeah, if somebody was smart, Rick, I think those of us that use water in our products, you can figure out some pretty solid numbers about how much business we're doing and what.
Exactly.
By the water usage for permitted and then what that wastewater is, and then the rest goes to product.
So another update from Jennifer on the fly here is she is willing to get dates from us that don't work. So if there's like an ag trade show or something that a lot of our folks potentially could be going to, then she's willing for us to send her dates in June that do not work. So I can send an email, Scott, to our council and kind of hold him on that.
Maybe yeah, let's do that.
To set up a joint meeting in Dublin in June. Tell me what dates do not work for you, and we'll try to accommodate those the best we can.
That sounds good to everybody? Keep an eye out for that.
Mark that down for me.
Got it.
I have a close affection for the joint meetings. I think that's a good idea. So I'd like to participate again. It's going to be where? In Dublin, you said?
Yeah, I think there's like a technical college there that has a nice.
Right
on our 16, the energy forecast. Yeah. All right, so we move on to the energy forecast. 115, look, we're really fast.
Everybody good with that section?
All right, so energy forecast. This is another one where we're in the process of getting it updated. We're about 90% there, honestly, and I had kind of hoped we would finish it up this week, which I think we probably will. Our last item that we're working through is we have what's called the Energy Ad Hoc Group. So these are folks from Southern Company, Georgia Power, a bunch of the local providers of electricity across the state of Georgia. And so they've been collaborating with our expert, Bill Davis, and updating not only the facilities, but even down to the units, and which units are being taken offline, and which units are being brought online, and the changes that have been made to the different fuel sources and things like that. So he's done most of all that update, has generated the numbers for the entire state of Georgia, and then parsed it out by Planning Council. And once the ad hoc group kind of gives their final blessing on that, we'll come back to share that with you. Just as an update, you know, refresh our memories on kind of how we go about this process.
These are the variables for calculation. So you look at fuel type, whether it's coal, natural gas, nuclear, and then what the prime mover is. So is it thermal energy and the mechanical energy? And then the cooling type, of course. Is it a pass-through cooling or an evaporative cooling? And of course, those are all, you know, different drivers, again, for how it impacts the water use. Some highlights on the methodology. So each power facility has a unique water to power production signature. Statewide, each facility contributes a unique portion to the entire power portfolio. The relative contributions of each facility can change over time as facilities retire or are brought online. And this information is used along with the total power production, which is an estimate from population projections, to determine the statewide and regional water needs out to 2050. And I think one of these in here, Rick, you had a point you wanted me to make, or you were going to remind me about, looking on this one, the unique signature and peaking production facility. Do you remember what that was?
Yeah, so one of the things that we're working with the ad hoc group is, so not only is there what facilities are coming online and offline, there are facilities that are either base load facilities or peaking facilities, and then for the facilities that are coming online, they may not be at their full generating capacity. So that's why it takes sometimes a little bit of time to work with the energy folks, really say, and there's been a couple changes in particular. You know, Plant Vogtle has come on, and then there's some changes, for example, in Coastal and Plant McManus, retiring some units, bringing some units on. Some of them are going from changing their coal as their primary fuel source to combined cycle because of the price of natural gas being a little bit better. So that's why we got to rely on those ad hoc folks to kind of give us as much insight as they can on kind of that unique mixture of fuel and that portion that each facility contributes to the overall energy portfolio.
Yeah, an interesting part of that, similar to that that CRISP plant, it's a trim plant for that hydro plant. And so with all the rain we've had, the coal pile is just kind of sitting there. They haven't burnt that little plant in a while because they've been generating a lot of hydro. Major floods where they opened every floodgate. Those kind of things really fluctuate. So you just have to keep those in mind that we're kind of looking at the quasi numbers on some of those kind of things.
Yep. So this table kind of shows you, depending on the power generation, what is the water consumption. So you can see at the top, for instance, when you do once through cooling, you need a lot of water. Per megawatt hour, but it's not a consumptive use of the water. They return it right back through. And, you know, on some of the other ones, it is a little more consumptive. And so we are, you know, obviously using those numbers as we work with the ad hoc energy group and incorporate that into the forecast.
It's not necessarily consumptive, it just doesn't go back into the stream.
Right.
They don't consume it.
No.
It just goes somewhere else.
It goes up in the air if it's evaporative, right? We will do updated energy needs, our estimate from the bean population projections. We do have two scenarios, a baseline and a high demand scenario are going to be estimated. The baseline is the expected energy need based on regression analysis and population projection. Standard error for the regression analysis is used to estimate the 95% upper limit for the high demand.
That makes sense. That's kind of pretty technical there. Kind of get that relationship. So you're trying to connect that regression is connecting, even though there isn't a direct correlation per se between population and energy, there's a relationship. You're using that relationship and saying, and power companies will kind of help us determine what that would look like, but does that then relationship kind of extend into the future? And is it reasonable then to use population and that relationship
to energy production to get that growth rate for energy. Recognizing that it's complicated because not only energy produced in Georgia stays in Georgia, and not all energy produced outside of Georgia stays outside of Georgia. So you do you have that relationship, and with assuming that those relative portions stay true, which is an assumption, then that's a pretty good forecast. And again, I'll come back and check that and make sure it all holds true.
And then a couple final notes here. So then the water withdrawal requirements and the water consumption rates based on that table as we showed you are used to estimate the withdrawal and consumption. And then the water withdrawals and consumption use are allocated through the region, the watershed, and down to the nodes. As I mentioned, results are not finalized. They're super close. Just waiting on the ad hoc committee to kind of give us the final numbers. And one of the things they have been wrestling with together as a team is in the original round one, we assumed that 1% of energy needs would be met through some renewable source, whether it's wind, solar, et cetera. Because Georgia Power and Southern Company has really been looking at this, and actually when we've been on the call with them several times, and Georgia's done a nice job kind of positioning themselves for the future of renewables, they think they can get it down to where they base the forecast for renewables by assuming some amount of megawatts will be satisfied through renewables instead of just saying 1%. So they'll have an actual projection into the future of how that changes over time. And they're helping us in working with that. And then despite what Scott just told us, we're assuming the hydropower is constant.
And the constant there is more the amount of power facilities, not necessarily their
They're not
their
battery fast.
And then so, you know, finally for this, we're working on it, and we'll share this with the council as soon as we finish up. So with that, on the energy side, open it up for any questions or discussion.
Just a comment about renewables. With the ruling on the Clean Power Plan, some of that drive it's gone away, especially on biomass. Let me put it in perspective. I think the numbers for Georgia is around 34,000 megawatts a day is our need. And they're looking at around, even under the Clean Power Plan, we were at around 400 or 500 megawatts a day renewable. So it's a small percentage of the total power. So even if you're off on the renewables a little bit, it's going to have very little impact on it.
I want to ask a question. I might not have to do this, but I want a question to answer. You might mention this one. What is a mega power?
A megawatt is just a megawatt. Or
yeah, one company I was working with said they had 55 megs of solar power online, and I didn't understand. Because I know another company is fixing to build 10 megs.
A megawatt is just a unit of energy, like a gallon or, but it's measured over time.
Yeah,
like a megawatt hour.
The confusion comes whenever you talk about, like especially with solar things, you talk about a solar panel generates X amount of megawatts, and then the people that use it actually use megawatt hours. So that's where it gets confusing, but you're really talking about megawatt hours. You is what you're talking about.
Megawatts.
He says 34,000. They're using 34,000 megawatt hours of. So something
that's
generates one megawatt.
That's number.
That's right.
But you have to generate that continuously to supply it. I mean, in other words, it's like a speedometer on your car. It's you're generating megawatts per hour.
And
that's based on demand, because there is no storage on the grid. It has to be produced instantly for consumption. So there's no storage on the grid.
And then when you get your bill, you get megawatt hours, and that's how much you consumed over the entire time that you
your bill's like the odometer on your car.
Right.
And your instantaneous usage is like the speedometer.
That's right.
So it's...
Well, I've been sitting in on several of these meetings and they was talking that, and that's why I asked
them. They don't pay to use your land for...
And so that's why we,
yeah.
Some of that stuff was...
Yeah, there's a bunch of that going on. And you see up the road, if you came in, that there's some of that going on because... I think a lap ball or somewhere in that kind of dating, but they had solar panels out there. But it is very small, and I think to Tom's point, it's 1% or 1.2% overall in the discussion. How much difference is it? And listen, these people are spending billions on building plants, power plants. They start talking about renewables, and I'm sorry for the group of anybody in here that's riding that wave. I mean, it's mainly on PR. That's the reason why they want them visible. That's the reason why you can see them from the road. So as far as the overall discussion goes, and how much impact does that the renewables have on, especially with our biomass. You know, when we first started talking about this, there's several biomass plants going in that were 20 megawatt plants.
Right.
And that's pretty much dried up. So. I don't think there's much impact.
It's all about economics, and every dollar we spend to generate power is spread to us.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
It's all we're going to pay for all of it. So.
Yeah.
All right. I think we're done with that one.
Okay.
Here, right?
Everybody.
Yeah.
Good with that. Moving on.
I'm still awake, right?
Yeah, still here with you.
Oh man, now we got ag.
That's right.
It's nice.
This is good stuff right here.
Ag, water,
meat, and municipal and energy stuff. I just want to be able to talk about ag.
Yeah.
You're still in good shape with that?
Just let's change it over. This is pretty much done before. Because, Jay, we pay for this no matter what, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So tell you what, folks, is everyone done? What I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and put that in there. I think there's a fridge over there. And then if somebody wants to take that home or maybe take some home with them, we hate to let it go to waste.
We're going
to
go to flash drive as well.
Please grab some before you go or grab a cup or something.
I got the
let Shane kind of help you out a little bit. He might be able to drop it. I'll be right back. I'll be right back.
I can pay you one tomorrow.
Yeah,
that's
a
forecast.
I don't know what that is. Mark sent this to me, and I just, I had to mess with it.
Looks good. Yeah, it doesn't work.
Go over some methods of how that was done, and then talk a little bit about the methods that are being used to update that forecast, and then Mark also provided us with some actual numbers for this region. All right, so who's Mark? Mark Masters is with the Albany State Water Planning and Policy Center. They are the Lower Flint Water Council's contractor. They're part of the University System of Georgia, but they're through the Albany State University over in Albany, Georgia. So if you remember back in the first forecast, you all remember Dr. Jim Hook, the University of Georgia team. They were the lead contractors on that forecast, and Mark Masters with the Water Planning and Policy Center assisted the University of Georgia with that. So, since that time, over the last 5 years, talking about things have changed. Dr. Jim Hook's retired, one of his key folks has retired, and fortunately he was still around, but the Water Planning and Policy Center are taking the lead role this time on doing these, doing the Ag Water Demand forecast, while Dr. Hook is working as an advisory, just a technical advisor to that work. So a little bit of a role reversal here on that. About Mark. Methods are going to cover the animal ag, horticulture sector, and of course the traditional row crop sector for the current ag estimate and ag demand. So that's about Mark what I just said. All right, does that look familiar? That's the process that we lived, breathed, ate, slept by from 2009 to 2011. So this is the overall process, and what we're talking about is obviously down here. I'm sitting here pointing at the screen. Wrong screen. Forecast of demand on the bottom is ag water demand is one of those components. That will feed into determining gap analysis. If all this is coming back to us, goes into the all of the councils, not just this one, but your determination of management practices and how you would like to address any gaps that are in the region. So that's just how. Oh, really? What I pushed to make that work. All right. Sweet. We're talking about one component of that today. So, let's go forward here. All right, so here's what Mark would want to tell you if he was here today. He would want to refresh your memory on the first water demand forecast, the one that's actually in the regional water plan that, that was adopted from this council. And so you can see this is information straight out of this council's plan. This is from the 2009, we'll call the 2009.10 ag water demand forecast. So he would want to refresh your memory on what drove this information, how this information was developed. Before we get into talking about how it'll be updated, we'll talk about a little bit about how it was developed. So if you remember, there's two big drivers for ag water demand. Irrigated acres, how many acres you're irrigating, and how much water you're using. Those are the two biggest drivers in the ag water demand forecast. Now we know there's other ag water uses like poultry, there's livestock, other non-traditional row crop agriculture. But primarily irrigated acres and how much water's been used on those acres, that's what's going to drive the forecast and drive these numbers. And so the first little piece I'm going to talk about is the irrigated acres piece. And how Mark likes to explain it is like building the layers of a cake. So if we want to think about this in terms of layers of a cake, it might help us to understand the information a little bit better. But layer one of the irrigated acreage component would be 1999, Georgia EPD, specifically their ag permitting program, began to build and develop a database of irrigated agriculture throughout the state. It did that in a whole lot of ways. It's still doing that, but we'll talk about that. But it went and met with farmers. It worked with University of Georgia Extension agents, and that has evolved. But that was the first layer of the irrigated acreage cake, if you will, that goes into ag water demand is the Georgia EPD wetted acreage database. So the second layer of that would be all of this additional work that's happened since that period of time. Specifically, we've had work contracts with the Water Planning and Policy Center to go out and do mapping of different parts of the state. We've had contracts with the University of Georgia to go out and map parts of the state. The Soil and Water Commission has contracted with the Water Planning and Policy Center through the Ag Water Use Metering Program. All of that data that these different contractors and these different state agencies and entities that are out in the field collect comes back to feeds right back into that EPD wetted acres database. So piece one is that database. Piece layer two is going to be all of that additional information and data that is collected by those entities in the field. And so the third layer of that first ag water demand forecast was a desktop analysis. Painstaking effort that the University of Georgia went through where they quadranted off every county in the state. They put a grid on it and analyzed it on the desktop with imagery, 2007 Google imagery, to determine what was being irrigated and make a determination on what crop they saw was actually being irrigated. So after that desktop analysis, that information was added to the EPD wetted acres database. So three different sources providing data into the irrigated acres piece of the ag water forecast. So that database that we're talking about, called the Wetted Acres Database 2009, was the one that was used in the ag demand analysis, and ultimately the resource assessments of this council and all of the other councils used also all worked together to provide that piece, irrigated acres piece of the ag work. So the second piece, that was irrigated acres, now we're talking about the water that's used on that acreage. A group of University of Georgia researchers, if you remember, developed crop demand forecasts, crop demand forecast models. So remember that we were planning out the horizon to 2050. You remember the guys named Jeff Mullen and John Bergstrom, researchers at the University of Georgia, said that, hey, based on the information we're getting from National Agricultural Statistics Service and based on information we're getting and seeing, we're going to project the crop mix for the entire state out to the year 2050. And they had some milestones along the way, that being, 2011, 2020, 2030, 2040, and 2050. So layer one of the water use cake was an estimate of crop mix by county. Okay? Layer two of the water use component was an estimate of crop water demand by crop, by county, and by soil type. So we ended up with a pretty massive database of information on that end. So for example, for corn in Turner County on sandy loam soil, this is how much water is needed. That was the model that they developed for every county in the state. So not only was it done for every county by crop, they also included climate scenarios. If you remember, it was a wet to an average precipitation to a dry year. So all this coming back to you. Good. All right. So then all of that fed back into the acreage piece. So that was the water use piece. But all of that information from that water use component fed back into the acreage piece, and that led to the forecasted demand over the planning horizon from 2011 to 2015. So that's what I want to show you now. Okay, this is supposed to be gray. It looks a little dark on the screen, but this below the red, the color below the red. How about that? Their water use estimates for groundwater demand. Okay. This is straight from our plan. This is the ag water demand forecast that we got. It's actually in the plan. Groundwater use. The red is surface water demand for that year. So the water uses are in millions of gallons per day. So for example, in the 2011, in this region for the year 2011, we forecasted here. That's about 135 million gallons per day for groundwater use in a dry year, okay? And we would see about 59 million gallons per day of surface water use in a dry year. So that's what that forecast says. And in 2050, the groundwater demand was projected to be about 155 million gallons per day, and surface water at about 69 million gallons per day, somewhere in there. So again, this chart came straight out of our plan. So the third piece that went into total ag water demand were these little pieces at the top. You can barely see them. There's little slivers on the very top here. And that's all of that. That's just the poultry, the livestock, all of those more non-traditional row crop water uses, poultry, nursery, animal use, container, things like that. Very difficult to see, but just in this region, it's an extremely small component of the water use that we have. So I'm sorry, that was a long time on that slide, but Mark would have wanted you to be sure that you had the right background on the original 2009 ag water demand forecast so that you can see and understand the information and the update that they are making in the new ag water demand forecast. So, let me stop there for a second. That was a lot. Any questions on that? Good. All right. So what are they doing this time? All right, so here's what they're going to do. They're going to look at animal and horticulture, except for water use. Also, in this presentation, we're going to look at the current ag water use estimates. The water use assessments. And we're going to look at them in a couple of different ways, two different ways. Finally, we're going to get a glimpse of the ag water demand forecast. So, okay, so that's what the rest of this presentation is going to be about. All right, so like I said, updating the current water use estimates are going to basically be based on the same methods, irrigated acreage, water use, same data, type of data, same methods that was used to produce the 2009 ag water demand forecast. So, for animal agriculture, it's not a real tough formula. How many heads of animals you got, and how much water does each of them use? Pretty straightforward on how you figure that out. The data that we used is being used in this new forecast is coming from the 2013 Georgia Farm Gate Survey. That's a newer survey and the USDA National Agricultural Statistics Service data. These are data that were also used in the last forecast, except for these are the newest the latest and greatest data that's going into that. So in addition to Mark's team talking to experts all over the nation, just to make sure that the numbers they're using for the head per, the water needs per head per animal are in line with what is accepted numbers across the nation, making sure that their assumptions of gallons of water per head are not off base. So the new information from Farm Gate, the new information from USDA, definitely makes for much better data than what we had in the first ag water demand forecast. On the horticulture sector, same type of approach. We have really good information in each county, in each of Georgia's counties, on the nursery and greenhouse use. We've also worked with Chris Butts, who's with the Georgia Green Industry Association, to understand the water use per acre in the horticulture sector. So that organization has been a huge help ensuring that the numbers that are being used are accurate. So that's essentially what's going to go into the ag water demand for non-traditional wood crops. An overall review is, I know Mark said, I believe he said they're going to do an overall review of this information. It's going to be performed by a group of industry expert people, and I did not understand if he said that was happening as in this week or if it's going to happen in the next couple of weeks, but it's happening in the very near future. Just to run over the information that they have on these non-traditional ag water uses, make sure that they have it right for folks who know what they're talking about.
I think you maybe said this and I missed it last time, but what y'all decided to do, are you going to hold golf courses?
Yes, so golf courses are partially taken into account. In Georgia's statutorily golf course water use depends whether it's permitted through agriculture or considered agricultural water use, or whether it's considered municipal or industrial water use, just dependent upon the geography. So on the coast, it's on the coast, surface water is municipal use. Groundwater is ag use. Throughout most of the state, it's considered recreational turf, so it's agricultural water use. So golf course water data is captured in the forecast. It's just a little bit scattered, and some of it will be captured in ag. In fact, probably most of it, and then some of it will be captured in non-forecast.
You're
going to
just hold that constant.
Yes.
Change in that?
No. In working with the golf course folks, they can see, I think, refer to them as to whether it needs changing. And no, it's still accurate, it's still valid since we worked with them during the first forecast. So, again, that's pretty much what goes into that. So let's look at this. Let's look at some data now. This is the statewide animal water use by the type of animal. Can everybody read that? We've got beef, dairy, goats and sheep, horses, swine, and broilers. Okay, the green bar is the 2009, with that original ag water demand forecast. That was what was forecast for that specific type of animal. And this tan, right beside the green bar, the tan bar, is the newest estimate, what we call the 2015 estimate. So, see anything surprising in there? You can see that the demand is pretty steady across the state, the biggest jump being in swine production. Okay.
Producing boy.
Who? Daphne County is one of them, but I don't know who it is. Well, this is statewide. I specifically remember Mark talking about it. And evidently there was other counties as well. Interesting thing, when we get to our region, somebody here is too.
I know they're picking producers, but I mean, who's producing more?
Oh, I don't know. Well, Tackle's added a lot of production. That's where Paul, you heard that call. Yeah, he has some insight on that. But evidently, swine is ramping up in production in several counties. But swine is driving animal water use.
I'm going to ask you, do they take in consideration the wild swine. I was trying to see. I know I've got a swine problem. I've got hundreds and hundreds of them, and I'm ruminating as fast as I can.
Yeah.
You're losing. You're fighting to lose about a
lot. It is. They're worse than rats.
That's right.
They, and that's why I don't know if they're. I think there's many in the wild that are in.
You're one in three.
That's a really good point. Yeah. But,
you know, interesting with in talking with Altamaha, they're seeing the same problem. And, it, all joking aside, it's a big impact on agricultural crop damage, and they've got a program that they're starting to work on down there to try to have some organized funds and using that to donate. So get together, and they have a really interesting project that they're launching down there.
If you want somebody to come out there, they don't have that program where you can sign up and they'll find you a legitimate hunter.
Well, I've got hunters coming out in the ears, and I call that, and they come up for free, and actually, finally, that they've been shot at so much and moving at night, so I've actually had three people win a couple of these thermoscopes.
Yeah.
So I'm setting them up next week.
Yeah, you can use a suppressor now, too.
Putting out there trying to get rid of them.
They'll wake you up. You have to come around the clock and sleep on
them. That is a major,
absolutely.
Major problem.
But no, they're not included in here, right?
I would not believe so.
So the kind of swine is a
Well, is that kind because we probably got down to 10 cents in 1997
to
return back. Yep. So there's 2.5 times as many.
Yeah.
2.25 times as many hogs getting home
in the state. Statewide. Let me show you this. See what happens in the brain. Is that better? This is each region, each water plant. You can look at animal water use. 2009 versus the 2015 estimate. And we'll be talking about. Look over here at Altamaha. Look at everybody else. Pretty much everybody's relatively same. I mean, not much difference. Altamaha is. Why is that? Because Tappan County has boosted production for sure. Here, heard that from Paul, gentleman serves on that council. He validated that.
That's one grower?
No, a major grower has been significant. Each piece, but I think there's a couple there's several new growers coming in. And Mark didn't get into a lot of discussion about what those drivers might be. Like, so obviously cost is some. Production in other neighboring states is likely to be in other ones. I know in working in Arkansas, they've been seeing kind of a decrease in a lot of their swine production there. So it could be get back to just kind of the national market too. But we can visit the market to see if there's there's anything that comes straight to mind in terms of why Georgia in particular might be seeing uptick in swine production.
So this chart conveys the animal, the daily water use by animal ag, by water planting region. Swine Zotilla, we have a projection of a slight decrease, just very minimal. So 2009 estimate was just over 4 million gallons per day. Current estimate, really just about the same. Again, it seems like all of my eyes was the data there.
What's the swing in the...
Savannah Upper Region. Yeah. I don't know. We can find out.
That's not that important.
Mark has the individual, obviously the individual data for each of these areas. His message, I remember, was basically swine is everything. Right? We should check on that. Be sure.
That's where to kill hogs.
Place to kill them.
Yeah. And the reason I say that is
going to Orangeburg,
Omaha has a representative on their council works for a large producer in the need. In light of this, line production increases.
Did you say whatever they were saying?
We'll see if we can get on the road.
Hey, Berry County has one large producer, Terry Danforth, and he sends all this to North Carolina.
Actually, Terry's, he's broker for several farmers. He knows a lot of farmers are all around this area, so all the hogs aren't coming off Terry's farm. And those really haven't changed. That's the reason why there's substantial capital investment in to raise those guys had some, but they don't have two times. And they also have to all be under contract. So the way that they, and you know, we don't have to get all in the weeds with this, but the reason why I question is because The only place to kill hogs is about 3 major plants. Two of them aren't really major. There's one major plant, and they own 90% of their kill. So who is contracting? If somebody had to buy dowels or, I don't know exactly what happened there. It's very extreme.
Well, Mark is scheduled to present at the joint meeting. And at that joint meeting, we'll obviously have multiple regions, all of our eastern representatives from our eastern region. So I think that's a good point to bring up at that is questioning that information.
We'll go ahead and send, Mr. Chairman, we'll send these to Mark just so he can,
or you can find out his answer.
He'll let us know. He'll hopefully be able to share with us at the joint meeting.
All right, I'll move on to the horticulture side. We see quite a drop across the board. Horticulture use, which is certainly not surprising, right? I mean, given the dry years of 2010, 2011, 2012, moving to 2013, very wet, that's not a surprise. So that data reflects that decrease in use across the board pretty well. All right, we're going to shift gears just a little bit. This is what we came for. This is the details for the estimate methodology. So this is the update to what all that stuff we just talked about. This is going to be the update of how it's going to be done in 2015. So again, I'm going to go back and talk about each component. I'm going to start with the wetted acreage. The wetted acreage piece first. So the Water Planning Policy Center, I told you all some work that they've done. They have delivered to EPD an updated wetted acreage database for the entire state of Georgia, the latest and greatest data set, if you will, on irrigated acreage for every county in Georgia. So to get the wetted acreage, let me tell you a little bit of the things that they did. Very, very similar to the things that they did in 2009. They did detailed mapping. Policy Center, like I said earlier, has done a lot of work. Or EPD, we've done a lot of contract work with the Soil and Water Commission. University of Georgia has done some work, but all of that information has continually been fed into that EPD wetted acreage database. And so to find out where the water is coming from and where it's being applied, they've actually gone out and done quite a bit of on-farm site visits to determine that information. So very detailed mapping, and then they actually went to many of these sites and looked at eyes on the infrastructure itself. So again, that information was fed into the wetted acreage database. They also performed on-farm wetted acreage mapping, sending their representatives and drivers out to actually go on some of these fields to the map sources and the acres that's been applied to. Matter of fact, in the lower flood basin, they've mapped on-site mapped about two-thirds of that basin. Then they have also moved over to the Ogeechee. And just last month, they started mapping in our region, the Swanee-Sotillo region. So they've begun doing detailed on-farm mapping in the Swanee-Sotillo area as of just a few weeks ago. And so, well, how does that information help? Well, what it does is, like I said, we started this stuff in 1999. think you know something, it changes. We all know how fast land changes hands. We know how fast the operations change. We know how irrigated acreage determinations change. So the work that the Policy Center has actually gone out and done, and others that have done detailed mapping, has helped us to clean up, continually clean up, our irrigated acres database. So, for example, what they might would do is, let's say in 2009, when they went out and did their detailed mapping, there was this funny-shaped field here, irregular-shaped field, as I would call it, that we had in the database that was irrigated by a traveler irrigation system. But it's good information at the time. So they go back now to that same field, and now there's a center pivot there covered. So what they do is they draw that center pivot in, and that information helps us to correct and update the data we have on what the source of supply is, as well as the acres that's being irrigated. So it helps us to refine what acres are actually being irrigated as compared to what acres are permitted. Okay? So to get the best estimate of ag water demand, we need to have the truest or most accurate number about what acreage is being irrigated. And so knowing that information does what? Well, what it does, we know the better we know that information, the more confidence we have in the ag water demand estimate.
Just so you
guys
know,
desktop survey. This is our makeshift screen here. It's tough to see. But for the desktop survey, which is the second type of initiative they undertook to collect this information, was of the entire coastal plain. And it was performed using the newest imagery. So remember back in 2009, they used 2007 Google imagery, but now they use 2014 Google imagery, which is fantastic stuff. I know you all are familiar with that. So so all that information that they got off this new imagery, and you can see these drawn in areas here, you know, all that information is fed back into the EPD wetted acreage database. So sorry, this slide is tough to see. Really see all the locations of the mapped acres, but all of that goes back to all that desktop survey of irrigated acreage. It goes back into as another layer of wetted acreage database. So let's move on to some data. All right, this is where it gets exciting, right? This is what we want to see. This is the irrigated acres out of the wetted irrigation database, and it's in alphabetical order. You can see here for all the counties in our region. But Irwin, Coffee, Turner, Brooks counties, they're still basically the largest irrigated acreage totals in the region. It's not much surprise on that end. However, since 2009, you know, they're not the counties that have experienced the highest percentage of increases in irrigated acreage. You can probably see that. Take a look at some of these other counties like Atkinson and Bacon, Marion County. See the percentage increases. Think about the percentage increases from 29 to 2015. Pretty sharp increases from a few years ago. Why is that? And I know commodity prices boomed in 2010, 2011. Commodity prices shot up. That's probably got guaranteed. So that has something to do with it. But, I was looking earlier to see if there was some correlation between the population and the irrigated acreage. I didn't see much. It kind of follows along in that a few of the counties that have seen the sharpest declines in population sort of have seen some of the highest acreage increases. I don't think they're related to one another. I just think it just happens to be that's the case.
Here we go. Can't get the insurance on Rutland or can
you? Yeah, you can. But the problem is your yields constantly going down the valley, and so your guarantees aren't good. premier. Premier.
Premium, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, you get the better premium for us.
It's just 4%.
Yeah, you get the insurance on a burning house.
Yeah.
You're willing to pay a premium.
So, Clint, Mark didn't mention this, but just gone on him, you kind of mentioned that maybe why the increases in commodity prices make a lot of sense.
Yeah.
How much do you think, I know maybe speculating, but maybe a result of just the additional work they did on cleaning up the database and the survey and all that? Do you think that accounts for some of that or any of it? Just better data?
Definitely the better data, but the data was really good. Jim looked in his tent back in 09, you know, using that 2007 imagery. And the data we had back then was good, too.
Yeah.
And the data, when I say we have better data today, that doesn't necessarily mean that we have more. It just means that we have more accurate data. So the 2009 picture versus the 2015 picture, it looks very different, not because we got anything new, but because this was a snapshot back then. Here's a snapshot today. So I don't think that a great change happened in terms of the accuracy of data, because today is their first place. But what we're seeing is a true trend, true change in land use from a real world snapshot 5-6 years ago to today. So, all right, let me move to the next slide. I'm going to move along here. Interesting slide here. So we have a little more detail on this slide. So what do we see from 2009 to today, really, 2015. You see that surface water use has declined. Not a big surprise to anybody here, I know. It's, you know, I can tell you from applications we receive in ag permitting program that folks don't want much water surface water anymore because it's never there when you need it. It's just not reliable. So it's, you know, the great trend going towards groundwater. So surface water use has declined over the last few years. The number of center pivot has increased 64%, and the center pivot acreage has increased almost 38%. Again, that snapshot of, you know, the data that we have now, more accurate data now, shows us what's going on today versus yesterday, 2009. And the total, here's the thing, total irrigated acreage in this region has gone up about 16%. I don't know what you think about that. Surprised or not surprised. But when I see that and think about a message from the 2009 forecast, which Jim Hook told us all, according to that forecast, that statewide in general, irrigated acreage would go up, and that's about 20%. In other words, I can recall them saying, hey, you know, there's, through the planning horizon from to 2050, we only got enough room in this state to increase irrigated acreage by about 20%. This region's hit 16% of that 20 in the last 5 years. Other regions' data that I have seen, and in some cases, have far surpassed, they've way surpassed that 20%. So, I'll show you. Really going up. if we look, well, yeah, you could look at this, I guess, down here. You could look at this in a different way, specifically by the type of system. If you break down all the irrigation system types in this region, you know, no surprise, we're center pivot covering most of the acreage. Travel irrigation, going down. I think, you know, obviously that's an efficient way of, in terms of water use, it's an efficient way of operating. Coastal counties can't even get a permit to use a traveler anymore, but seeing in this region, certainly declining folks coming in, not really asking for travel irrigation water use. So all that was the wetted acres piece of the updated forecast, okay? So let's talk about water use. All right. So if you ask the folks on this council or any other council, you know, what's your message with regard to ag water use? Well, the big message is the last round.
throughout the state is we need more meters. We need more metering data. And you need to start using that metering data in your demand projections. And that was the big message we heard all around the state. And so that's happened. A little different here, Rick, in that on the snapshot of wetted acres, that was a snapshot, not necessarily of a more accurate data set. This is an increased data set that has allowed us to be used in the water demand forecast. So these actual wetted acres numbers, and they're going where you want me to go, okay? Your question about how do you know that this is used on, this is where I'm going with that. All right, Eugene, this is what you were asking for. We're using meter data that has been captured over a four-year period, 2010, 11, 2012, 2013, on the approximately 12,000 meters that are in Georgia right now, okay? So these are application rates, average meter application rates. In other words, the data that has been read on all those systems, whether 6-inch, 8-inch, big pivot, small pivot, whatever, that's where this shook out. Here's your rates. And you can see that depending on the weather, what we use more, what was used less. And there was one other thing about this is that if you remember back in 2009, ag water demand forecast, there was an assumption that was made that groundwater use was 70% of the surface water on a farm would be a third. Well, you can see that right here. So again, and I'll say in this region, you can see that. And that proved itself true through that data that we got from those ag water use meters. All right, so this provided a really nice data set. We had a really nice data set of information. If you remember that the first year that I received meter data was 2007, at least the first data set using a robust data set. So we've added to that over the years. So 2015, here we are 8 years later, got a really nice data set that we can use to determine how much that's going to actually use. Okay. So looking at meters, checking to replicate what was done in 2009 to get a percentile across a really wet and a really, really dry spectrum. So in this water council, the meter data was actually used in the assessment. We had really good acreage information. Again, you can see the acreage, you can see the application rates, 2010 through 2012, again, were drier years. 2013 was a very wet year. So you have your groundwater use and your surface water use application rates for this region from the meter data read. All right, so let me move to this. This table is the updated acreage, and as we discussed earlier, it's one of the things that drove the results of irrigated acreage did. So let me move to the next slide. So the current demand estimate for meter data is what I'm going to show you next. All right, so here's where Mark would say it's very, very important at this point for you to understand what you're looking at on this slide, okay? So, I'm going to give a little information here, point out what each color of the bar indicates. So in 2009, ag water demand forecast was from 2011 to 2015. We all know that. That was what is shown on this graph here as well. The only thing that's been done to this is that the 2020 and 2040 have been removed just so it doesn't look so gunked up on the slide. Just to give a view of it a little easier. So 2011 is the dark bar here. The darkest bar is a 2011 forecasted groundwater use. Wet year. You remember the 10th percentile, 50th percentile, the 90th. Wet, medium precipitation year, 90th percentile was a very dry year. Okay, so you got two things going on in the slide. You've got the forecasted amount for 2011, the year 2030, and 2050 for a very wet year. All right? With me on that? So basically what you see is a linear relationship. You're looking at it, and 2011 to 2050, you basically see that the water use just compounds linearly. So before I add any information to the slide, let me stop. Is there any questions on that? Everybody pretty sure what they're looking at there? Again, the middle, let me go middle tan bar here, the 10th percentile represents a forecast of about 30 million gallons per day of groundwater use in the 2030 forecast for this year. So this is the water forecast or irrigation water requirement under the old methods used, ag water demand that we just covered. I spent a lot of time. This is that information, groundwater use under the old methods used in the 2009 forecast. So I'm going to show you how the meter data and this data that was collected from 2010 to 2015 fits into the original ag water demand forecast. In other words, I'm going to show you how what was pumped, how that relates to what was forecasted.
But we know what that number is.
Which one? No.
2030.
Oh, no, I don't.
Any
exact number?
No. We got it for the region, right?
Yeah, we have it by county, by planning node.
No. Really, you're only talking about 3-4 counties, right? All of the South Dakota.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone.
So you could choose 400 million gallons.
400 million gallons.
So,
which counts?
That was state.
Oh, for state?
State ag water use?
State ag water use over the planning horizon?
Yeah.
I was just curious what it was now. I don't even know that he gave us that data. I didn't in that way.
I'm not sure, in the summary document, the roll-up, what we call the roll-up document, we can double check. We'll see if they got
statements. It's not that important. It just comes up in conversation.
Yeah.
We come to somebody from another state, and they go, well, how much water do you guys use? And they really talk about groundwater.
Depending on what state you say, not very much. But, Cliff, I don't know if we totally know the answer to this, but to tie a little bit more on to Eugene's question, so this is the forecasted information. So in the forecasted information, correct me if I'm wrong, because I know we're trying to rip this note to Mark, and I went to look at the answer. This would be information that was derived from crop irrigation models. So it would be, is that correct?
Yeah.
From the forecast.
Absolutely.
So that would be using soil and plant physiological science. This would be how much under the best conditions that the crop would demand aggregate from all the major crop types that we forecasted. We didn't get into that more into the major crop, cotton, soybean, So that's what's real important, but now what Cliff's going to show you is the actual meter data. So it's not an apples to oranges, it's a way of kind of showing what the quote-unquote theoretical is in terms of what the measure
is. I got a question for you, Greg, because I'm having a little bit of a hard time understanding how you come up with these numbers. 30 million gallons per day, is that what you were saying?
Yes. Well, on the plane when I said that, it was the 2011 forecast for a wet year would be 30 million gallons per day for cotton.
Okay.
For
that, if you use 28,000 gallons per acre inch, that's only 1,071 acres. Now, not all of that water is actually used.
Well, it's only used if it
you know, subject to rainfall. So we would have forecast under average rain. No, excuse me, under very wet rain.
Say that one more time, Charlie. Did that happen?
An acre inch is approximately 28,000 gallons.
Right.
So if you divide 30 million by about 28,000 gallons, you come up with 1,071 acres. That 30 million gallons would put 1 inch. Is that right?
Well, no. Now, what this
that is a day.
What this has is
so like you
multiple put, crop types involved, okay. And a rainfall scenario applies to it.
Okay, crop so you're saying that, that part of that does not use the entire piece, that there's only part of that water being used. That
I think now here's where you get confused with ag. The 30 million gallons a day yearly average.
Okay. Annual average.
You're not growing your crop
okay.
all
so
year round.
You only turn it over, what, 20 times?
So that's 1,000
okay.
acres
so
a day.
This is on an annual
basis. That's 1,000 acres a day for 365 days.
Okay, I'm
sure. So you're probably, you're both right. You're right.
That's
an annualized number.
Yeah, I couldn't figure out how that number would work.
We got tied up like that before because, you know, somebody was saying, well, that's a huge, when in dry time, they're saying, well, that's a huge number. And somebody said, well, you're looking at that like they're using that every day, but
yeah.
It's actually just a short period of time.
Absolutely. It's the seasonality of the use.
Yeah. So it's a lot of water for a very short period of time.
Very short, quarter of the year.
I understand that.
I couldn't figure out how to do it. Groundwater only, 123 million gallons. So the 2010 data here is based on the wetted acreage that we went over, and also the meter data application rates that were collected through the data from the Soil Water Commission stuff. So wetted acreage meter data application rate. So where does this fall? This falls at about the 70th percentile. Okay, this pumping amount is a little higher than our medium year, but it's still short of what was forecasted for a very dry year, okay? So let me throw up 2011.
Sam was considered a dry year?
Yes. And then it got drier.
Yeah.
2011 pumped a little bit more. Just over 172 million gallons per day. That is, we pumped in this region the amount forecast for 2011 in a very dry year, and it was. As a matter of fact, in the lower Flint, it was the driest year on record over there. So, probably
so it was more like 100% high that night.
Exactly. It was easily 100% there. So that's the 2011. So 2010, a little higher in 2011, and then 2012. So little bit better. Starting getting a little bit wet. It's about the same as having pumped in 2010. Way down, right? Only less than 89 million gallons per day, but still almost at the 2011 forecast for a medium year. But you say, well, it was a really wet year, 2013. How the heck did we actually pump that much in 2013? Remember the acreages we were just talking about? Yeah, this region added a lot of acreage. So that's dry we pumped. So that number is where it is. Instead of being down here, it's up there because we had acreage. That's simple. Okay. All right. So, any surprises in the way that this turned out? Not from the
not from the researcher standpoint, not from the EPA standpoint. I think that basically what this information shows all passes the common sense test with regard to climate, with regard to how much was actually pumped, or the application rates we saw, and with regard to the irrigated acreage that was added. So again, those bars are the forecasted demand, and the lines are the actual observed pumping amounts. Okay? I'll move on. For surface water, I'm not going to belabor this. It's the same thing for surface water. Again, forecasted amounts. All right, forecasted amounts of the bars, and then we're going to add on top of this the actual observed amounts of surface water. Okay? This is 2010, 47 million gallons per day. Comes out about the 75th percentile of a very dry year. 2011 was about 60 million gallons per day, and a little bit drier if you remember. So we hit about the 85th percentile of a very dry year. And in 2012, it was feeling a little bit wet, so we got just under 51 million gallons per day. We're getting back towards that 80th percentile of a dry year. And here we go again in 2013. We saw surface water pumps well below the forecast for the medium dry years, yet still higher than you would expect due to the increase in irrigated acreage. Okay? So in this, now, in these data, we can see an increase in groundwater use, the switch from surface water to groundwater. And we can also see the decrease in the surface water. We can also see the results of the acreage increases that we experienced in this region. All right. Stop there or keep moving?
Keep rolling.
All right. All right, so what all did we just go over? We talked about the approach to updating the new ag water demand estimate forecast, all right, the 2015 forecast. We talked about how it was done in 2009. We talked about how it's going to be done now. And basically, they're very, very similar, with the exception of more accurate snapshot of data on acreage and increased data set for water use for the application rates of meter data. All right, so we talked about the acreage piece, the crop projections through 2050. We're going to use those same crop projection models that were used, those are the terms that we have. And the crop water needs, again, will be projected in the climate scenarios of wet, medium, and dry years. So when you see this new forecast, it's going to look very familiar to you in terms of format and content. As it was, except for the fact that we have much better data today than what they had back in 2009. All right, and I think I already mentioned this, just wanted to tell you again, as was done the last time, we're going to have the forecast of water use by basin, by water planning region, by the drainage area node. Y'all remember what a node is? It's those USGS stream gauges. County and by aquifer. So we'll get to see all of that information in those same units, the same as you got to see in 2009-2010. Again, for dry, normal, and wet years. And this information is going to be used to support, like we showed in that graphic at first, where we talked about how each piece feeds into the gap analysis and how that leads to the council's determination of management practices. Same thing here. This is going to be used to feed the resource assessment model, and the councils will use that information to determine what management practices it would suggest or recommend for use against the results of those assessments. And that's it. Yeah. Thing. Nothing shocking? It's good.
A little shocking, but it's really important.
Yeah. And swine.
A little bit.
Get that answer?
Oh, yeah. Right away.
I like playing less and get wrong.
That's right.
All right.
That's a lot.
All right.
I guess.
No.
We'd like to say, hey, so you're ready. Senator Isaacson's office is just a table. We'll say the best to wait.
Shane is changing out a little bit. As you guys go back and talk to your other council members, and I know this stuff gets incredibly intense, but as you can see, it just builds on itself. So having this foundational forecast information is so important for council members to start getting up to speed, because by the time we go to the joint meetings in June, we're going to now be talking resource assessments, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. But remember, probably one of the biggest challenges we had last time in the water planning effort is making sure we understand how, like what Harold has just done, is how we take these average annual demands and how those average annual demands then are used to essentially understand how it affects the resource. So those resource assessments are being updated just in terms of technically, where Dr. Kennedy modeled, where Dr. Booth had modeled for both the quantity and quality of surface water, but then how they model these average annual forecasts and demands is really important, and you pointed out so well just looking at that number on an average basis made no sense in terms of practicality. So we want to make sure it makes sense how they model. We got our work cut out for us still. The good news is we communicate a lot of that information, and they've been working real hard to try to do a better job of understanding what we didn't get into today. Dual sources of supply. When is something being pumped from groundwater to surface water? Is being accounted for as surface water, where it really came from groundwater? What's happening with return flows? What's happening with consumption? So I guess I just put that out there to get our other council members excited about making sure they get to the meeting, so that they don't get left too far behind and have to try to catch up.
All right, so put this on the agenda for appointment of technical subcommittees. And I know this did kind of vary from council to council, whether they had it or they didn't. Were they generic, like there's a technical committee, or some actually had very specific technical subcommittees around one issue or concern that was important to the council. So here, just to open up the discussion and us to report back to UPD, because we will work with you guys in a facilitated fashion if it's like a conference call or a webinar to allow y'all to ask questions, maybe break down some of the data and information. We'll get into some of the details and then help you kind of synthesize that to bring back to the larger council in the council meeting session. So that's something that's on the table for you guys for consideration, that we could develop those technical subcommittees now, work with you between now and June, and have something to come back if you want it or not. If you didn't do them today, it doesn't mean you can't do them in June and in future meetings. So
I'll open up the discussion by